How's it going, guys? Welcome back to another video. And today is another end of year list. Very excited to talk about this one today because we are ranking all of the comic book movie releases to come out this year. We got 14 films to talk about today. I'm very much looking forward to talking about all of these films on the list because they all were rated pretty good. There wasn't any one that I saw that was so bad. I do want to make a quick disclaimer. There are a lot of films out there that are like based on comic books that like I have no idea. I tried to compile as many of them as possible that I knew that I saw, and I came to the grand total of 14. I could be missing a few. I don't think so. There were a few I was like, I'm not sure, but then I came to my realization, I'm like, no, those aren't comic book movies. Like Mortal Kombat is based on a video game. Sorry, it's not a comic book movie. But that's basically the disclaimer, is there may be like one or two that I missed that fell through the cracks because I just didn't know that they were made based off of some random comic book that came out decades ago. So bear with me. We're still talking about 14 today, and we are hitting all of the big ones. So go down below in the comments. Let me know, what is your favorite comic book or superhero movie that came out this year? I think I know most people's answer, but you may like something other than that one that I think everyone likes. But go down below, let me know. And of course, if you haven't already, please consider subscribing. It does mean the absolute world. Truly helps the channel, and it makes me feel happy when I see that my sub count goes up. Let's get to 1K as fast as possible. Thank you all so much for the support. And let's get into this list. Coming in at number 14 is Venom, Let There Be Carnage. Now you're saying, whoa, Jack, 14, whoa. I really enjoy this film. And that's what I'm going to say about all of these films. I really enjoyed every film that I watched. So just because this is down to number 14 does not make it a bad film. Just happen to enjoy the other ones more. That's all I got to say. It's better than the first, just barely. Barely better than the first. The thing I love so much about the Venom movies so far is that relationship between Eddie and Venom. It's the best part of this film. They took it to 11. This film, in the first one, they didn't really exploit it as much as they did in this one. And I think that was a good decision, and I really liked that. Woody Harrelson's having the time of his life in this film. You can see it. You know it. I do not love his character, but I do like the performance, if that makes any sense. Andy Serkis's direction is fantastic. It really, really is good. This is nowhere near a perfect movie at all. I have problems with a lot of the writing. Again, I don't love Woody Harrelson's character in particular. I think they really should have just stuck with the Eddie and Venom relationship. And while they do that a lot, I don't think they do it enough. The mid-credit scene is awesome. I really enjoyed it. And yeah, I gave it a 78 out of 100, and it comes in at number 14 on my list. Coming in at number 13 is Batman, The Long Halloween Part 1. This is one of the DC animated films. I had heard nothing but good things. This is a two-parter. I had heard nothing but good things about these films, so I decided to pick them up on Black Friday and check them out. It's pretty good. Really like the animation. I think it's extremely well done. The story has some pacing issues. It runs really long for a part one, and it doesn't get very far, but I found it very compelling. I was intrigued throughout. This is Batman doing what he does as a detective, and I really liked that. It really definitely feels like a part one. It was extremely incomplete. But with part two, it did elevate it a little bit. I think overall, this is a very well done animated film. I think the Joker is a great villain. I really like Batman in this, and it's really all I got to say about it. I think overall, it's a nice watch. I don't think there's anything too special about it, but it's good. I mean, it's pretty good. I gave it an 80 out of 100. Enjoyed it for what it was. It comes in at number 13 on my list. Coming in at number 12 is The King's Man. This is one of the ones that I did not know, but I did my research, and it is based off a comic book. The King's Man series and franchise is based off of a comic book series that came out before the movies came out. It's a very entertaining but bloated mess of a film. The spy stuff is really awesome. I really enjoy it, and that's what I love about any of the other two as well as this one. The spy stuff is a lot of fun. It really is awesome. The family drama, not so much. And this film just came out, so I'm not going to give away spoilers. I'm not going to get into any of that. But if you've seen the movie, I think you know what I'm talking about. I do get through what they were going for. I understand they took the risks, but it just took up too much time, and it fell very flat, and at times it was boring. I mean, The movie's a long movie, and the spy stuff makes up for it a little bit, but when you dive into the family drama and things like that, I just didn't really like that. However, Ralph Fiennes is phenomenal. He is great in this movie. I really liked his character, and the action is kick-ass. It's a Kingsman movie. What do you expect? The action is kick-ass. It's a little too long, a little too bloated. The screenplay is a little, you know, leaves a little bit to be desired, but I still enjoyed aspects of it. I gave it an 81 out of 100. It's fine, it's serviceable, and it comes in at number 12 on my list. Coming in at number 11 is Batman: The Long Halloween Part 2. It's a nice conclusion. I think it ties up the first story from Part 1 into a nice bow in the second one. It's a little messy with its storytelling because there's like a lot going on at once. So the storytelling gets a little convoluted and messy, but the action is nice. I like the themes around family and legacy. I think that those cut deep, especially in this second part of the film. It is a very well thought out conclusion to the first half, and it's got awesome Batman moments. It's not really much to say. Again, I think the villains are great. I really like Two-Face. I think these two films thrive at having Batman be a detective, and that is why I'm so freaking excited for the Batman this coming year. It's going to be freaking awesome, but I really enjoyed it. 83 out of 100. It's very serviceable, and it comes in at number 11 on my list. This is going to be my hottest take of the entire video. Coming in at number, 10? Coming in at number 10 is The Suicide Squad. I've done multiple things. I've done a video review. I've done a podcast episode on this. I've talked about it. I'm not going to defend how I feel about this film. I'm just not going to. So if you're going to come at me, just come at me. I'm just not going to say anything. Just you get angry, do whatever you want. I'm not going to say anything. It's fun. There's no doubt about it. I had a lot of fun with it. I think the action's great. The performances are awesome. Margot Robbie is to die for as Harley Quinn. She's just one of the best castings of any film of all time. But I'm very sour on the writing. I've talked about this. I have fleshed this out so many times before. It's the same feelings I have towards Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. It's too much gun. Too much gun is not always a good thing. He hit lightning in a bottle with Guardians of the Galaxy, the first one, and then he just replicated it in the second one and in this movie. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. It's a lot of fun. It really is. I loved a lot of the moments. I enjoyed a lot of the characters, but it is not as great as I wanted it to be. It for what it was, but the writing is extremely piss poor. That's all I'm gonna say. Come at me in the comments and let me know. I still gave it an 86 out of 100. Everyone calm the f down. It comes in at number 10 on my list. Coming in at number 9 is WandaVision. This is the most overrated thing I think Marvel put out this year, so I'll leave that where it may. But there's still no doubt that this was a really great return to form for Marvel. I think that the performances are great. There's no doubt. I think Elizabeth Olsen in this film, in this series, is to die for, along with Catherine Hahn. I think they are great. You get some really nice character development, some really intriguing mythology. There's no doubt about that. The show really struggles with pace, though. It's, I believe, a 10-episode series, maybe 8. I don't remember. This came out in January, so I do not remember. But it really did feel like several episodes were straight up filler. And I understand like maybe an episode being filler or something like that, but there were like three or four of like the 8 or 9 episodes that were like pretty much just filler. And it also did not ever, get the landing on the cliffhangers. It never stuck the landing on cliffhangers. It never did. So I'm very sour on this one. It does not take away from the fact that this was a really nice, again, return to form for Marvel coming back from the pandemic and it being the first series that came out on Disney Plus. It's got a lot of really good redeeming factors, but there are a lot of flaws. And I think the finale is too short and there was too much going on. And I didn't love where they took all of that, but we're getting Agatha, House of Harkness. Wanda's going to be in Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. We'll see. But again, I did enjoy it for what it was. I gave it an 88 out of 100. Everyone calm down. It comes in at number 9 on my list. Coming number 8 is Black Widow. Incredible action. I think this is some really airtight writing. I do. I enjoy it. And you get some really awesome performances. This is the introduction of Florence Pugh as Yelena, who I absolutely adore. She is just absolutely fantastic. The theme about family obviously is the biggest thing that stands out here, and it really resounds, and it's done extremely well. And it's a very meaningful send-off for Scarlett Johansson and Natasha Romanoff as Black Widow. It really, really is. I think it was done with a lot of grace and a lot of dignity, and it really was written well. Florence Pugh's teen stealer, I love her so much. This is a fun film. I think it's... We finally gave Black Widow the time to shine. We finally gave her film, and it was awesome, and I really enjoyed it. 89 out of 100. It was pretty damn good. Comes in at number 8 on my list. Coming at number 7 is Eternals. Everyone hates this film. I love it. It's fresh. It's inventive. It is a breath of life into the MCU. It takes the cookie cutter and destroys it. This is not a normal MCU origin story. Chloe Zhao, we trust. She crafts the most unique film in the franchise so far in all of the right ways. The twists are big. The stakes are real. And the MCU truly will never be the same after everything that we have learned in this film. There's a lot going on. The story's definitely dragged down. I do not think the script is perfect, but it does redeem itself in other aspects. I also didn't love all the performances either. I'm sorry, Richard Madden. You were stale as a brick. And I love Richard Madden, so it really pains me to say that. But there was enough going for it that I still really enjoyed it. I think it's extremely creative. The post-credit scene set up a lot to be desired. I'm very excited. I also gave this one an 89 out of 100. It just inches out Black Widow, and it comes in at number 7 on my list. Coming in at number 6, the series I just finished tonight, the night I'm recording this, is Hawkeye. This one's interesting because there's just not a lot going on. It's very low-key. It's extremely low stakes. This is the lowest stakes of any show that's coming on Disney Plus so far, and that was good. For all the right reasons, because it doesn't need to be high stakes, because it's Hawkeye, it's a guy with a bow and arrow. I think that the chemistry with Hailee Steinfeld and Jeremy Renner is incredible. I really, really do. I think the action is awesome, and the writing is really solid in here. It's got great emotion, awesome themes, and it really tests Jeremy Renner's Hawkeye, and I really liked that. Florence Pugh's back. I love her. She was better in this than in Black Widow, and that's saying something because she was great in Black Widow, but it really does come down to Hailee Steinfeld and Jeremy Renner. I think that without this series lives and dies on their chemistry. If the chemistry sucked, I do not think that this series would be that good, but they are fantastic. This is a really fun series. It gives you the holiday vibes. I'll watch it every year around Christmas time. It is great. I really did enjoy it. Enjoyed it more than I thought I would, which is saying something. 90 out of 100. It really was fun. And it comes in at number 6. DC fans, eat your heart out. Coming in at number 5 is Zack Snyder's Justice League. Leaps and bounds better than the Justice League mess of a movie that we got in 2016, I believe. Amazing character development, fantastic heart, and some of the best cinematography of any comic book movie. Not just DC movie, of any comic book movie. Some of the best cinematography. This is Snyder's baby, and you can tell there is so much heart and passion put into this film, and it was so worth it, and it really was so awesome. The action is grand, the characters are compelling, and Snyder fans, are you proud? I'd be proud. I mean, I think it really was everything we could have hoped for and more. And the Flash going back to use the Speed Force left chills down my spine, and I was in awe. It was just awesome. So I really enjoyed it. Give it a 91 out of 100. It comes in at number 5 on my list. Coming in at number 4 is Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Another kind of hot take, because I know that people are not as fond of this series as much now as they were back then. I still think that this is top tier MCU. I do definitely have to rewatch it. I am starting my MCU rewatch with my family when I go home on vacation. And once I get back, I will finish the rewatch. I'm not gonna be able to finish it there. We're gonna go like to Endgame, and then I'll finish the rest after. But you get a combination of kick-ass action, some really awesome performances, and very risky, but I feel rewarding writing. I think the writing here is very sound. I know a lot of people critique it and don't like it, but for me it worked. And it tackles some issues that are real. And people may not have liked it because they're tackling them in a comic book series, but what better place to do it than a comic book series that a lot of people watch, that a lot of people resound with, and a lot of people react to and identify with? I mean, why not? I think it worked. I think that Sebastian Stan and Anthony Mackie are fantastic, and I was very excited to welcome in the new Captain America. It was awesome. I give this 94 out of 100. Again, this may shift the next time I watch it, but I still really enjoyed it. It comes in number 4 on the list. Coming in number 3 is Loki. This is the best Marvel series that's been put out so far. I will say, disclaimer, I have not watched What If. I gotta watch that sometime, probably during my rewatch of Marvel stuff. I have not seen it, so What If's not gonna be on here. But this is the best Marvel series so far. The direction is brilliant. I think it's incredibly shot. And the pacing. They nailed the pacing in this show better than any of the Marvel shows that had come out so far and still have come out. I think Hawkeye does a pretty good job, but there's not a lot going on there, so the pacing is not as crucial, I feel. But in this pacing is extremely well done. Performances are fantastic. Tom Hiddleston is great. He really is. He brings his A game here. I love Sofia DiMartino in this as well as Sylvie. And the mystery throughout the season never gets dull. I think episode 4 is great. Episode 6, the finale, is absolutely fantastic. And you get Jonathan Majors as Kang showing up for the first time. I think that this is the best written series so far in the MCU. I'm very excited for season 2. The MCU has broken up big time. I don't know when the multiverse started. Did it start with Doctor Strange and Spider-Man No Way Home? Did it start with Kang and Loki? I don't know. Let me know. But there's no doubt that I absolutely loved this. It's absolutely awesome. I gave it a 94 out of 100, and it comes in number 3 on my list. Wow. Coming in at number 2 is Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings. Safe to say I'm a little surprised, because this was not at the top of my most anticipated. There were other things that I was anticipating more than this, and this completely shattered my expectations. It's the new hero that Marvel needed to kick off Phase 4. It's Simu Liu as Shang-Chi is absolutely awesome. I love him in that role. This was a new twist of the straight-up origin story in the MCU, and it was really fresh. I really liked how they kind of did all of that. Performances are awesome. Not just Simu Liu. I think Awkwafina is great. I think everyone else involved is amazing as well. And the action. The action is what does it here. This is action we've never seen in the MCU before. It was choreographed incredibly well. I really, really was on the edge of my seat. I loved the action in this film. It was just incredible. Like I already said, Simu Liu is a star. I'm very excited for the future of Shang-Chi in the MCU. He's absolutely fantastic. I really loved, enjoyed this film. Give it a 95 out of 100. It came in at number 11 of my ranking of films this year. But it comes in number 2 on this list. But coming in at number 1, I think this is the most obvious of any list I'm going to do this year. Coming in at number 1 is Spider-Man No Way Home. It's the Spider-Man film we needed. I think it's the best written Spider-Man film of the home trilogy, if not any of the films, honestly. I hate to say it. This is a film that really tested Peter's will. It made him do it on its own. It made him, you know, have nothing. The writing is stunning. Like I said, I think this script is extremely airtight. It is very, very good. Performances are electric. The emotion runs incredibly high. You know, I'm still not going to get into spoilers, even though it's been a few weeks, but runs very high. I really enjoyed this film from start to finish. Spoilers, they brought in Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire. I'm so glad they did that, because that's what Peter needed. He needed them there. And I've gone more in detail on this on my podcast and things like that. But I really love this film. I cannot wait to rewatch it infinite amount of times more. It's one of not just the best MCU films, it's my favorite comic book film of the year, and it is one of the best films of the year. It came in at number 3 on my list of favorite films of the year, and it comes in at number 1 on my list. And guys, that's pretty much it. Go down below in the comments, let me know, what is your favorite comic book project to come out this year? There's a lot of good ones. I think a lot of you are going to say Spider-Man No Way Home, but still, comment down below. Subscribe if you have not already. Thank you all so much for watching. Hope you all are having a great holiday season. We'll see you in the next video.